Without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce Andrew Jones. excuse me. Born and raised in Salt Lake City, Andrew Jones graduated from Highland High School, go Rams, and then attended the University of Utah, where he received a bachelor's degree in economics with a minor in Spanish. He later attended Mount San Antonio College in Southern California, where he received an associate's degree in aviation science. After spending just over 12 years in the workforce, Andrew went back to school one last time, where he obtained his master's of business administration from BYU in 2019. Andrew spent the last 18 years at Tempest Enterprises, a fifth-generation, family-owned underground pipeline construction company, where he currently serves as the vice president slash owner of the company. Andrew has been married for almost 20 years to his brilliant and amazing wife, Callie. He has two boys, Stephen, age 12, and Wyatt, age 9, who he absolutely adores. In his spare time, Andrew enjoys coaching all his son's sports teams, traveling anywhere from St. George to Thailand with his family, golfing, and following college and pro sports. He loves hiking and running and has completed 21 marathons. There will probably not be a 22nd. So please welcome Andrew Jones.
Oh, thank you. We on here? Okay, good. Well, wow, that's me in a nutshell. I don't know if we missed anything, but I'll kind of stand over here. I am super happy to be here with you all today. I've got my little notes and so I'm ready to go. First, I want to thank Russ Tanner. Russ and I do go way back, your professor. He is one of the world's great human beings. And when he and I ran into each other, of all places, at a viewing, we started talking about this, and this has kind of come to fruition. But I'm super excited to be here, and I just think the world of this guy, so I'm excited to do it. Second, it's great to be back on a college campus. I love the atmosphere and the feeling that goes around learning and college and everything is about. I know with you, you'll talk about, you know, group stuff and you got to answer questions and you want it and, you know, assignments and tests and midterms. But once you've passed that, you do end up actually missing it. So it's fun to be here. Actually, a couple years back, I went to California to see a football game with some friends, and it was at University of Cal Berkeley. And I was walking with some friends, just went to see the campus. We don't normally just cruise college campuses as old men, that would be creepy. But we were walking along and it dawned on me. I was like, oh my gosh, the students here are half my age. And I looked at my friend and I said, do you think they look at us and say, those guys are old, what are they doing here? And he patted me on the back and he said, yes, they do. Because the time does go by so fast that you don't realize you've been out of college for so long. And I had a little bit of a return, which I'll get to in my presentation, from 2017 to 19 when I went and got my MBA. But anyway, but what I want to talk about today is, and hopefully what I can help out with is, I didn't really know what I was going to do in life till I was like 26 or 27 years old. And I'll explain why, but I want to, as I kind of take you on the journey, I want to hopefully steer you a little earlier in the right direction, I guess, or not right direction, just wherever you think you need to go. And also, I'll tell you how really impacted me. One day in my life was the best day of my life and the worst day of my life, all in one day. So here we go. Oh, maybe not. There we go. So this is me and my family. That's my wife, Callie, and then my oldest son, Stephen, and my youngest son, Wyatt. Love these boys. Just a great, I could go into all of my family and all the things, but you guys would be bored to death, but these are the people that I adore. Me and my wife, it's 20 years in June that I'll be married. I've got a big anniversary that I need to get a big gift for. Anyway, okay, so slang terms when I was in college. The only reason why I wrote this down is I was doing this presentation on Friday night. I was working on it, and my son, he's in junior high. He went to hang out at someone's party. He's graduated from play date. You don't say play date when you get to junior high. It's hanging out. And he to let me know that. And we were sitting there, and he comes home, and there were going to be girls at this hangout that he went to. So when he came home, he sat down. And I said, "Hey, did you get any digits?" And he goes, "What?" And I said, "Did you get any digits?" And he goes, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Phone numbers. Did you get any girls' phone numbers?" And he goes, "Dad, no one in the history of the world has ever used digits for phone number." And I was like, "Oh, yes, they have." That was a slang term. And right as I was doing the presentation, I looked up slang terms when I was in college, which would have been the early 2000s. And this is what came up. Let's bounce. Oh, snap. That's fat. Bling. I'm totally bugging. Take a chill pill. Hey, home skillet. And sup. So this is more for my entertainment than yours. But that's what was going on when I was in college. Now, yes, I have run a lot of marathons. I don't look like I've run marathons. I'm kind of a dad bod marathon runner, but this picture makes me laugh because this picture does not say marathons are fun. This was after I completed the St. George Marathon, and I was hurting in that picture. Oh man, I was in so much pain. But this is probably the apex of my running career. I'd qualified for the Boston Marathon, which was a goal of mine. You have to get a time to do it. And my wife snapped that picture. And coincidentally, I ran the Boston Marathon the year of the bombing. So that's another story for another day, but it was kind of the apex of my running career. And the reason why I love running is, you know, there's the physical exercise, there's the endorphins, the stress reliever, and there's a lot of life lessons in running about overcoming hard things, especially in like distance running. So that's a little bit about what I like. Now, this is where I work, Tempest Enterprises. And this is our success triangle that we live by: safety, quality, production. In the construction world, you have to be safe. I mean, you are putting inherently with big machinery, or whether you're building buildings, or whether you're digging ditches like we do, you have to be safe. Quality, have to do quality work. The funny thing about our work is it gets covered up. At the end of the day, all the pipe we get from the ground, all our work gets dirt on it. And it's kind of funny, we can build a whole masterpiece of pipelines that go every which way, and it's very technical, or sometimes it's not, and then it just gets covered up. But it still has to be quality, because if it breaks or ruptures, there can be a real problem. Nobody thinks about flushing their toilet until the toilet backs up. No one thinks about a gas line break until they don't have heat in the middle of winter. No one thinks about washing the dishes or taking a drink until they don't have water. So it's very important, but it's also kind of it's kind of disappears to people's mind. But a couple of fun facts. Tempest was established in 1933, so almost 90 years in business, well, 89th year. Fifth generation, family-owned underground pipeline construction company. I am actually the first non-blood, if you can believe it, owner of the company, one of them anyway, and we'll get to more of that later. Licensed in 7 Western states, and yes, we run sewer lines, water lines, power lines, telecom lines, and our real niche is natural gas, and we do a lot of work for Dominion Energy. So that's where I work. And these were just photos that have taken under the years. That guy right there with the back, he was one of our long-term foremen. He actually passed away a few years ago, but he worked for our company for 40 years. This is us installing a pipeline down through Delta, actually. Southbound was a big project they did in the 80s and 90s. I wanted to bring up some older photos. They ran when we ran gas all the way from Salt Lake to all the towns, including this one, along the I-15 corridor and Highway 89. This was in Lehigh just a couple years ago, and they did that whole tech corridor expansion and all the weaving and out, and we did all the gas lines for that. And this was us getting underneath the overpass right at the 2300 North exit. We do welding, and this is, in order to weld, there's residual gas. You got to light it on fire, so this can get, you know, it's an ignition source. So the welder's getting some outlets where the gas can breathe so he can weld it so he doesn't get an arc burn or a flame coming back on him. This guy still works for us today. That's named Milo Vival. That's him in a bulldozer. He's been at our company for over 40 years. Some of the long-term guys, they stay, and they are very hard workers, very, very good people. Okay, the Tempest Way. That right there in the ditch is my father-in-law. He worked for Tempest before he sadly passed away of cancer in 2005. I actually never worked with him. If I could have a conversation with one person that's passed away, I would probably choose him, because not only do I work at his company and have worked there for 18 years, my wife and I actually bought the house that she was grew up in. So I'm kind of, in a way, living his life. But the Tempest Way is everyone that works there has to, especially family members, and I said I'm non-blood, but the joke is I'm related. You have to work out in the field. When I finished some of the degrees he was talking about, I went out and I worked on the construction crew. I started as a laborer at my company. It didn't matter what I'd been, right from labor, then I went up, we have pipe fitter, fuser, foreman, superintendent, all the way on up. But this is him down in the ditch working. And it's to teach us the, you know, kind of the ins and outs of the business. Another, just different photos. This was up by the Canyons Resort. This was in Fallon, Nevada, another 40-year plus employee that retired last year. Big trench. This is actually very unsafe. We should not have that guy down in there. This is years ago. Another big pipeline. The trench, if you see the pipe at the bottom and the guy standing, sometimes we have to dig through just big hills and washes and crevices and try to make sure that everything stays intact and be safe. Now, before I play this, this is kind of how I feel about my employees. Do I just hit play? Oh, right here. Let me see. Oh, that's my next slide. Here we go. It just keeps going through. Let me see here. Sorry, bro.
If you go to the slide,
this is what's popping up.
Okay, let's see. When I did it, I had to actually click on this.
Oh, there we go. It's slide number 17, yeah. Oh, well.
Oh, you're not connected to the internet.
Oh, that's why. Yeah. Okay, I'll set this up a little better while we're doing that. So this is a show, McFarland. It's a running movie. I like it. And it also has a lot of life lessons. But not only do I love this movie because it's about running, I really like what it teaches about hard work. And when you guys, and you're probably already doing this in life, at some point you'll probably have to juggle between school and work. Come on. And, okay, here it is.
So look around.
Let's see if this is gonna work, sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
So, I'm just trying to make it big. I'm just gonna.
Yeah.
Hi, everybody, gather around. All right, everybody, gather around.
Anyway, he goes up and he talks to him and he gives him a really inspiring speech. And what he's showing him is they go and they work hard.
All right, everybody,
field,
gather around.
Run.
Come on. I want you to look around. Best in the state, right? Every team that's here deserves to be, including you. But they haven't got what you got, all right? They don't get up at dawn like you and go to work in the fields, right? They don't go to school all day and then go back to those same fields. That's what you do. And then you come out with me and you run 8 miles, 10 miles, and you take on even more pain. These kids don't do what you do. They can't even imagine it. When I went out in the field that day with you Diaz kids, I'll be honest with you, it was the worst day's work I ever had to do in my life. And I said to myself, whatever kind of crappy job I end up in, it'll never be as tough as that. You kids do it every day. And your parents hope they can do it every day. And they'll do it for a lifetime if it means a better life for you. You guys are superhuman. What you endure just to be here, to get a shot at this, the kind of privilege that someone like me takes for granted. There's nothing you can't do with that kind of strength, with that kind of heart. You kids have the biggest hearts I've ever seen. Now go run your race. Thomas, you're the captain.
There we go. So one of the reasons why I like working at my work is, one, it was an opportunity for me, which I'm going to get to in a second. Two, when my father-in-law passed away, I went to his funeral, obviously, and I met a lot of the workforce. This is before I even worked at, I didn't even think I was going to end up there. And I'll get to that in a second. But I saw all the people, I got to interact with them, I got to talk to them, and then, so at Tempest, if you ever see any, we drive all red trucks, red crew trucks, red, almost every truck we have is red. And instead of having a procession, what they did is we actually loaded his casket up on one of our bigger crew trucks and had a procession of all of the other crew trucks to the cemetery, and had a profound impact on me, it really did. And then actually, a little bit later is when I started working at Tempest. And the other reason why I love working there, besides the profound impact that it had on me, is some of the employees that we have that have risen up in as leaderships, they're getting a second chance in life. Some of them had a rough past. Some of them even served jail time. But I love that it gives people second chances and a pathway to rise. I unfortunately have had a lot of opportunities in my life, but I love to see people rise up. I really do. Anyway, so that's why I work there. So now you know a little bit about me. I'm kind of your average Joe, but what I'm here to tell you guys is we're not average. When you guys find your niche in life, then you'll know what you want to do, and you will, you know, you help contribute to a community. I'm sure, I don't know if when Russ was sitting, when we were sitting in high school, we went to the same high school, that he was thought he'd be down at Snow College teaching, you know, as a professor, that I would be in pipeline construction. I never even dreamed of that. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. So that's what I do now, and I want to go along a pathway of where, you know, sitting where you are to where I am now. Not to say in 2 decades you'll be standing here giving a presentation, maybe you will be, but just when I started there, you know, my father-in-law in the ditch. So when I got done with one of my degrees from California, I got a phone call from my wife's uncle, and he said, "Hey, do you want to come work at Tempest?" And I was like, "Well," and I had just finished air traffic control school, and it takes about a year to get hired. That was my degree in aviation science, and I was like, "Yeah, I guess." And I what I thought about at that time wasn't working in the construction industry. It was knowing my father-in-law and seeing what his lifestyle was like, and thinking, "Oh, well, I'll do that." I didn't know, 18 years later, it's a lot different, the ups and downs of an 18-year career, than I thought it would be. But I'm grateful. I was grateful for the opportunity, and we'll talk about that. This is my dad. He's not a basketball player. This picture makes me laugh. This is like, I don't even know why this was taken, but he's kind of got that flowing mane and anyway, curly hair. So that's really why I threw it up there. But he said to me one time, he said, Andrew, it's going to take you a while to figure out what you're going to do in life. But once you do, you'll probably be good at it. And that really, at the time, I was like, ouch, Dad, geez. I was, you know, I'm this like spacey 20-whatever-year-old, not knowing what I'm going to do. And I was just like, okay, well, what does he mean by that? He couldn't have been more right, actually. And so that's his quote. And so my life lesson number one, I guess, if I'm doing that, is don't just assume. Because what I was assuming when I went to him, my whole life growing up, when I knew Russ in high school, I thought, I'm just going to work for my dad. My dad runs a financial planning company in Orem, Utah, has for years. I grew up, I'm going to work for my dad. Anytime anyone asked me, I'm going to work for my dad. I never researched it, never saw if that's what I wanted to do. I just said I was going to work for my dad. I show up day one after I graduate from my undergraduate degree at the University of Utah. I sit down in my cubicle and I think, I don't think I want to do this for a living. This is 25 years. I sit down, I'm like, I don't think I want to do this. A year later, I left. That's when I went to air traffic control school. So if I don't know, I don't want you to take away from opportunities because I said we'll talk about that, but I research now. If you have a connection or maybe your parents or someone that works for a big company, see if you really want to do that before you actually do that. So don't just assume. Oh, let's see here. This is my...
To be liked? Absolutely not. I like to be liked. I enjoy being liked. I have to be liked, but it's not like this compulsive need to be liked, like my need to be praised.
Okay. I love that too. It's going to do it again. Okay. So how do I get back? Is it this one? Oops. How do I get to the presentation here?
It's on that screen.
Yeah, let's see. Oops. Sorry, guys. I'm kind of fumbling around here. Let me just do this. There we go. I just needed to get out of it. Okay. Sorry I'm being slow on this. I used to use PowerPoint a lot, and as you can see, it's been a while. Okay. We're back. So here we go. This is a funny picture. This is me and my wife on our first date. And actually, I walked into a party and she was wearing angel wings and I looked at her and I said, I'm going to marry that girl. And I did. And I don't know how it happened, but it did. And this is not a presentation about love because I am not the person to be talking about that. But, or a presentation about Halloween because as you can see, I am a horrible Halloween like dresser. I don't know. I was some sort of, I had like a Japanese kimono on with a, anyway, don't ask me for Halloween tips. I like Halloween, I'm just not. But this is our first date. And what I learned for that is life lesson number three, take opportunities when the world gives them to you. I was at the U of U, I was doing my generals. I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life except for probably work for my dad. And she whipped me into shape. Because I literally would go to classes and sign up for classes that my friends said were cool. I didn't know if they actually worked towards my degree or my undergrad or anything. And so that's where I came from. And she really helped me get into that. So don't, you know, map out a plan, I guess, is that one. Here's what some of my friends do. Doctor, FBI, private investigator, software sales, firefighter, high school teacher, football coach, medical sales. You can see all these. Which one of these careers constitutes success? What do you think? Well, this goes to my life lesson number four. Success does not equal money. Money is nice. Money is convenient. Money, it can afford you to do things, but it doesn't equal happiness. That I have learned in life. I'm not saying you shouldn't strive to make a good living. I'm just saying one of the high school teacher on this, my friend, I've talked to him before, he left a big firm to go back because he just wasn't happy. And he knew his salary was going to be cut in more than half, but he loves what he's doing now. So really what it comes down to is passion versus reality versus opportunity. This is kind of one of my mantras. Always be weighing your passions. Always don't forego opportunities, but you have to be real with yourself on paying the bills. I used to think when I was going up, and even when I was working at my current company, that it wasn't my passion. I'd always tell my wife, I'm not passionate about this. And she finally looked at me and she's like, well, do you have to be? This is like one of your best opportunities. And now I find myself, I'm more passionate about running a business, but I had to pay my dues to get where I'm at. So now I am more passionate about it. But at the time it was the opportunity and a lot of times the reality. One of my other good friends is unfortunately going through a divorce right now, and he absolutely despises his job. He hates it. But the reality is it's paying the bills right now. So for the short term, you always have to be weighing those things. Okay, I'm gonna be better at this now. Okay, now before you say, let me just say this. Life lesson number 6, you are always worth something. And that's what I like about that video. And the reason why I threw that in there, and don't, before you say, okay, thanks, cheesy middle-aged old man, for throwing in the, token video about you're being worth something, just think you are. One of my failures in life previously is I have lacked confidence. I have not believed in myself. When I was working out on construction crews and it was hard, and either it was really hot or either it was really cold, and I felt like my career wasn't taking shape yet, I'd get down on myself. I'd get down on myself hard. Stay positive. Later on, I have a quote that I live by, but just, you are worth something. You will find your niche. And I just wanted to throw that in there. So, okay. Back to my story. So I've gone to, there's one college that you probably don't know, Mount San Antonio College. It's in Southern California. It's a vocational school. I actually got an associate's degree after I got a bachelor's degree, which is kind of reversed for a lot of people. But I went there because I was going to be an air traffic controller. That's what I thought I wanted to go into after I didn't do my dad's work. So I was going to do that. It's a very stressful job. But anyway, so I leave that, I go, and then I leave my dad's job, I go to this, and I load up the U-Haul, I go out there, I packed a two-year degree into 1 year, and after that's when I got the call, and I went and worked to where I am now. But what the biggest thing that a school has taught me is confidence. Really, that's what it teaches you, because I have a degree in economics, I have a minor in Spanish, and I have a degree in aviation science, and I'm a pipeline contractor. I'm not landing planes on the right-of-way for pipelines or anything like that. But every time I went back to school, it taught me confidence. So if you're sitting in college and like, why am I here? Why am I learning this? Trust me, it helped me. Now, here I was like 15, 16 years into my career, and I had learned everything there was about the family business. Well, everything they had to teach me, I'd learned. And I thought to myself one day as I was driving, I want to go get a master's degree. And I talked to my two bosses, one's now my business partner. I said, I think I'm going to go back to school. And they said, why? You do not need that to be an owner here or whatever. And I was like, I know, but I just want to be more well-rounded. I felt like I knew what they had taught me about the business, but I wanted to see what the world had to teach me about business, about the disciplines of accounting, finance, marketing, operations, you know, you name it. I wanted that, I craved it. And I went back to school, I get there the first day, I sit down, we were doing a meet and greet, we're all in our suits, we're taking our pictures, we're down in Provo, you know, very Provo-ish. And I saw the door, because, I mean, little known fact, I'm a huge University of Utah fan, but anyway, that's beside the point. I was there, I was at BYU. And I saw the doors and I literally almost backed out. They were grouping people in which cereal they liked the best. And my cereal nobody else liked, and nobody does. I like Cocoa Pebbles, I don't know. But nobody liked it, but I was by myself. And I was like, I'm just gonna back out. I haven't paid for anything yet, I'm out of here. But I stayed, that was like the intensive week that I went through. Next day we go and we're sitting in a class and they were like, don't worry, we know you're all stressed out right now, but you know, there's 80 of you students, and then of the guy said, of like the 15 years I've been teaching, we've only failed out 4 people. And you know what my thought process was? I'm gonna be the fifth. That's what I thought. I'm gonna be the fifth. So, but I made it through, and it gave me massive amounts of confidence. Not arrogance, but it gave me confidence, sorry. I would say, my life lesson number 7, school and therefore knowledge gives you confidence. Remember that. Okay, I think we got time for this.
It's only bad for you, and it's gonna end up bad for me.
You think I'm hurting you?
Yeah, in a way you are.
That's the last thing I ever wanted to do.
I know that's not what you want to do, but that's just the way that it is. Don't you care what people think? Doesn't it bother you that people are making you out to be a joke and that I'm gonna be included in that? Do you think that's right? Do you?
You ain't gonna believe this, but you used to fit right here. I'd hold you up and say to your mother, this kid's gonna be the best kid in the world. This kid's gonna be somebody better than anybody ever knew. And you grew up good and wonderful. It was great just watching. Every day was like a privilege. Then the time come for you to be your own man and take on the world, and you did. But somewhere along the line, you changed. You stopped being you. You let people stick a finger in your face and tell you you're no good. And when things got hard, you started looking for something to blame, like a big shadow. Let me tell you something you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward, how much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you wanna be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that. I'm always gonna love you no matter what. No matter what happens. You're my son, you're my blood. You're the best.
Okay, the reason why I like that is, in this slide that's popping up, he said a lot of good things in that, but mostly, life will hit you hard, but every success in every sense of the word, you have to work hard. You really do. There's very few people that get a free ride. That's my life lesson number 8. Most every successful person has to work really hard. When I worked 8 to 10 years out in the field, like I said, in the height, it was hard work, but it toughened me up, and I appreciate it now. I might not have at the time, but you're not going to be president of the company after 1 year in the workforce. Enjoy the journey of paying the dues at whatever you decide to do. Enjoy the journey. And what people like to see, and this is what I saw in my father-in-law when he owned this, they saw success as an iceberg. What people see is above, but they don't see the stress, the hard work, the failures, the persistence. That's what they don't see. Okay, this is my quote that I keep on my desk every day. Our reaction to situation literally has the power to change the situation itself. I truly believe that. You're hit with a lot of things in life, and your attitude reflects that. And part of my lack of confidence is me counteracting it with this. I remember when I turned 30, my 30th birthday was a lot harder for me than my 40th birthday. Because my 30th birthday, I turned 30, I felt like I hadn't done anything yet. I felt like I hadn't done anything. By the time I was 40, I'd kind of kicked myself into gear and I'd gone through some stuff. I was more battle-tested and torn, and it was easy for me. It wasn't like that much had changed other than I'd kind of changed my thought process. And here's the little secret. Life lesson number 9, you'll never figure it all out. Keep learning. You know, I would sit, when I was in my, even in grad school or when I was in my undergrad, I'd have presenters come like this, and I'd think, man, I gotta be like, not that you guys even wanna be like me, but I think like, I gotta be like that guy. But the thing is everybody's figuring it out every day. I'll have employees come to me and be like, I don't know how to do this. Can you help me? And I'll look at what they're trying to do. I don't know how to figure it out, but confidence to try and learn how to figure it out is what you need to succeed. And that's what I've learned. Like, I have a new safety director. She comes to me all the time. She's like, I don't know how to do this. And my response in my head is, I don't know how to do it either. But then we figure it out, and it's fine. So you just got to be willing to. Okay. This ties into my life lesson number 10. The smallest deed is better than the grandest intention. I saw this the other day, probably a few months ago, and I really liked it. You can have the grandest intentions in life, in your career, in your personal life, but if you don't do anything about it, it's nothing. So my life lesson number 10 is always serve. That keeps you grounded, it keeps you humble, and sometimes it's your turn to be served as well. It's a reciprocation. Again, it'll keep you grounded. And that's what I've learned in my life. In my work, when I serve others in my work, somebody that's bugging me, I can serve that person. It helps our relationship. And so then about a year and a half ago or so, we were going through some real hard times. Well, not some real, but a hard, we lost a big contract at my work. And it ended up actually turning out to be a really great thing for the company. But at the time, we were kind of stressed about it. And so we were sitting in a staff meeting, And I'd written these down the day before to help myself, but then it kind of became somewhat of a mantra for a while, and I need to bring it back up to kind of circle back, because I was living by it by a long time. Be visible, be real, be positive, be present, be grateful. And for us, it was be visible with the clients that we work with, like as a management team. We can't just have all of our workforce out there. We need to be visible. Be real with them, be honest. As the older I get, the more I'm honest with people and like don't hide what I'm doing. Not that I was a liar back in the day, but just, hey, I can't do this because of this, or this doesn't work out because I'm thinking this. Be honest with people. They appreciate that. Be positive. Negativity will kill a culture of a company. We've been through that in cycles. It really will. Negativity is just a vampire to companies. Be present. When you're talking to somebody, don't be distracted. I mean, we have so many distractions. Be present with people. Hear their problems. And then be grateful for what you have. And that was what we were doing at the time. We needed to be grateful for what we'd been given. We were a 90-year company. Okay, this is one final video. How much time do I have? Like 3? Okay, we'll skip this. This is a very inspirational. So go to Rudy, watch it. You've probably already seen it. I'm going to skip that one and go to the last, last slide here, because I want to wrap this up. Okay. Okay, in closing, I can't leave without telling you about Willa Tempest Jones. I actually have been lying to you guys the whole time. Not a bad lie, just I actually have three children. This is my firstborn daughter. Her name's Willa Tempest Jones, and she passed away of a brain tumor not too long after she was born. It was undetected in the pregnancy, and it affected me profoundly in my life. And it was really hard. I still think about her every day. But what it taught me, besides empathy for what anybody's going through in life, is it taught me, after I went through about a year or year and a half of numbness, that I kind of had an awakening to myself. And all of these life lessons that I've taught you about and kind of my journey, it helped me to kind of see the bigger picture in life. And I don't mean to get too personal with you guys within in a college class, but the awakening that came to me is kind of that life lesson number 10 about serving. And the more I serve at work, the more I serve in my community, the more I serve in any situation that presents itself, I feel better. And hard work, the other life lesson, can help you serve, and it helps you progress in life. And this is my little angel. She's with me all the time. I truly believe that. I strive to be better because of her and because of my other kids. But what I will say to you is, what do you lean on? What do you fall back on in your hard times when you're going through those ebbs and flows? That would be my final question for all of you is, what do you lean on in life? Find that, find your foundation, and it will help you grow into success, what the true definition of success is. Thank you.